Hey everyone, Missy D Interviews is back. We are here with Charlie Kerr, and I'm excited to get interviewing it to be back on your screen. You're gonna notice it's a new format. We're trying out Zoom. Like always, this is episode 21. And to get us started, we're gonna listen to a song by our guest, the song of the day, I wanna call it. It's called The Eyes on You by Hotel Mira. And because we're on Zoom, I can share a little bit of the video, but I'm going to invite you to go check out that video. So here it is, The Eyes on You. Check it out, and I hope you enjoy it. Those dance moves are coming from Charlie Kerr and the band, the Hotel Mira. Thank you for joining us to Missy D Interviews, episode 21. I am super excited to get to talk to Charlie. If you don't know who I am, my name is Missy D. I use she and her pronouns. I am joining from the land of the Squamish today with Tupi Musqueam peoples. I stand in solidarity with my Indigenous communities, my BIPOC communities. I stand in solidarity with you if you're watching right now. Missy D Interviews, the reason it exists, it's just I wanted to check in with community builders, creatives, artist, you, if you want to get interviewed, let me know and have this human connection. I know 2020 kind of isolated us in many ways, and I just wanted to hold space, whether it was through the internet, through the web, through Zoom, and find ways to get to know each other. Sometimes you run in the green room and you're like, good set, dope, you're amazing, and you kind of run away from the person. This was an opportunity to really sit down and get to know that person. My first guest, if everything is still on.
Oh yeah.
Amazing. We were just watching Hotel Mira's The Eyes on You. Fun fact, I was actually watching a lot of your videos the other day. Kind of looking at the discography. I think the artistry of all your videos and your music in general has a similar theme. So I feel like I'm transported on a journey, and I can go on and have some questions in regards to that and how you come about the vision of those videos. But
yeah,
people that don't know you, you are my guest for today, goes by the name of Charlie Kerr. You may know him as the lead singer of Hotel Mira, and how I remember first meeting you, I think I was watching you on stage. It might have been Westward Music Festival or one of those kinds of festivals. And from your stage presence to your vocals, to your energy, and just the pure joy that you can feel the audience feeling, I was like, I don't know who that is, but I need to know them. I need to say hi. I need to greet them. I need to know that they, I need to tell you, and I don't know if you remember this, I might have come up and be like, great job, or like a little quick admiration high from the back, because I was like super intrigued by who that was and fascinated by your stage presence and the way you performed. I was like, this is a performance. So today, for the people watching, before we get started, Missy D Interviews, we got a little jingle. So here's a little song just for my guest. Hopefully it goes well. This is for you, Charlie. Can you hear this?
Yeah.
Okay, because I'm still working on a little production thing. I like to sing to my guests and introduce them. So this is how it goes. Okay, it goes 3, 2, 1. It goes like introducing, interviewing, tune in online. We checking in. Missy D Interview. Missy D Interview. Introducing, interviewing, tune in online. We checking in. Missy D Interview. Charlie Kerr. Hey, Charlie Kerr, Charlie Kerr, Charlie Kerr, yeah. I already see those dance moves. Charlie Kerr, how are you doing today?
Oh, better now. Holy cow. That's awesome. Man, way to make a guy feel welcome. That's, man, that was so cool. That's really this is awesome. I'm currently in Toronto on tour, supporting the Zolas and just in my hotel room and yeah.
I love it. Well, thank you for joining us. To people that don't know you, I like to start off with my round one question. So I introduce you on how I know you, but how would you introduce yourself to the people listening and watching this?
I'm a musician and an actor and a writer and a songwriter. I'm a human being who is trying to do the right thing whenever I can. those are the things that are sticking out in my head right now.
I think those are great things that come to mind, and I always ask this question because I think it's also powerful to hear how someone introduces themselves. Like, I could have asked you, like, Sammy, your intro, and this is the spiel that I will give about you, and I think I invite people to do that when they check out your website, when they check out your music. But also, I think it's beautiful to hear how one introduces themselves to a group of people or to just me and you kind of in this conversation here. And the fact that you hold different facets as well, I think for people like myself who didn't know, the more research I did, the more I was like, oh, I did not know this. Okay, I'm going to ask him about this and this and this.
Oh, cool.
So here we are, Missy D interviews. My round two question, because it goes by fast, but don't worry, there's a lot of rounds.
Okay.
Is a check-in question. So I mentioned at the intro, the reason I did this originally was just like, hey, 2020, let me check in with my artist friends, see how they're doing. And even like a chance to get to know people. Like I often feel like we don't have the opportunity to sit down and actually have a conversation because we're busy trying to set up for our show or
right
kind of get the energy before we're on stage. So we're not as social as people might think when we're seeing each other at shows. So my round two question is like, how are you feeling in general? Or like the way I like to ask this question, if you had a song of the day or an emoji or emojis to describe your day today, what would be those emojis or the song?
Okay, well, like, the emoji whose head is exploding because his mind is blown.
I like that.
That guy. Probably like the prayer hands, because I think that's the one for gratitude. It's the like most universal one for gratitude. Yeah. Probably those two.
Love them.
Just happy. Grateful and really in a spot where I had no idea how much I was going to miss going to live music and performing live music, and being on the road has really clued me in to how important it is for us to gather safely and go through either a really joyful experience or a really cathartic experience together, whether you're in the crowd, in the audience, or on the stage. I just think it's really really healthy, and I think what we kind of found out is without it we lose touch with a lot of things. We kind of lose touch with how much we're actually in it together.
I couldn't agree more. I feel that, like, when I last saw you, we were performing the same show. I was like, wow, I've not seen a crowd in so long. And it felt so good to even just watch people. I was excited to perform, but trust me, being in the audience, I was just eating with a friend, and I was just like, wow, this is so exciting. And I'm like, I really love this. Like, it reminded me how much I love music.
Yeah, man, it was a joy to see Desiree and yourself and Ludic perform, and everybody that day. It was just so rad for that to be our first show back.
Yeah, I love it. Oh, I'm glad you're feeling that little explosion, little gratitude, little sort of taking in all the joys of performing. And I've seen some clips. I interviewed the Zolas for Zach a couple of months ago, so I'm excited. He had mentioned going on tour, and I'm like, yo, when I saw your name, and I was like, oh, this is so full circle, and I'm happy for both the bands touring. Round three is one of my newest rounds. It's called Through the Wire. It goes through the wire, to the limit, to the wall. For chance to be with you, I'm glad we risk it all. some Shaka Khan, who originally was like Through the Wire by Kanye West, but actually originally is Shaka Khan's song.
The sample.
Oh, yeah. Which I learned doing this round. I was like, she says through the fire? I was like, wow, my mind was blown that moment. But the reason I named it Through the Wire was, I'm going to give you a random year, and I want you to think about a story from that year, or a person you want to give a shout out to, or something that was memorable about that year. What do you remember about that year?
Yeah.
If you're cool. Comfortable, share it. If you want to pass, just say pass, because you know sometimes you want to move forward. And I'll give you another year.
Love it.
Okay, so your year is gonna be what were you doing in 2015?
Oh wow. I think I was like barely able to like put a sentence together of just like being mentally unwell. I don't think 2015 was like, I think personally it was a pretty tough time for me, if I'm recalling correctly. I can't remember. Like I was making music and acting, but that kind of chunk of time from like, I don't know, 2009 to 2017, it's pretty blurry. Just surviving, you know. Pretty blurry. I wish I had a cooler, funnier answer.
I mean I made this round, and I'm like, if anybody asks me the question, I'll be like, my memory is, I sometimes chunk off some periods of time where I'm like, I can tell you which country I was in. That's about it. But that's the most I can do. Maybe you mentioned, I'm curious maybe to know, if you can't remember the specific event, I'm curious to know, in 2005, is there a music genre that you were listening to? Is there an artist that was like on replay all the time that you're like, this was my vibe, this was my cup of tea? Because 2005 is a long time ago. I don't know if you remember 2005.
Yeah. It would have been like The Strokes and The Killers and The Arcade Fire and The Hives and The White Stripes, like that entire garage rock revival around that time. We were just obsessed with it, you know, as kids who were into rock and roll. It was really, really exciting.
Yeah. Oh, I don't know why. Like sometimes I tell my friends, that's also some of the music I listen to.
Yeah.
I know people know me to listen to hip hop, and I did, trust me. That's my love.
And likewise, I mean, I've definitely gone through times in my life where hip hop is the main thing I'm listening to. And people maybe don't expect it.
Yeah, but there's a mixture. During that time, there was an era of like Like I grew up with the Blink 182 vibes.
Yes.
That era, the Good Charlotte days.
Yeah, MCR like, must.
Yeah. Too. Exactly. I don't know why it transported like time, and all of us were listening to that while listening to 50 Cent and Nelly, something like that.
Yeah.
I'm gonna switch up the vibes, and I'm gonna go to someone I listen to sometimes, which is Miss Lauryn Hill. This round is called Nothing. So it's a rapid fire round. I'm gonna ask you about one thing that you do, and just say the first thing that comes to mind.
Okay.
So Charlie, what is one thing you do every day?
Besides wake up. drink coffee. It's pretty consistent for me at this point. My band all kind of has this like running joke of just like, it's so corny, but it's just like we're always being like, where's the coffee, you know, like
that's in your writer.
We're all hopelessly addicted to coffee. So I do that every day.
Is that in your tech writer, like for the band?
I think it's like a veggie tray and some water or something. We're really boring.
Yeah, I feel the same. I most of the time I'm like, I think I need to ask for more. I didn't even know I could ask.
Yeah,
so I feel you on that. And what kind of coffee, like what's your go-to coffee? Are you like coffee with cream or nah?
A long time ago, my ex-girlfriend served Sam Rockwell a cappuccino while he was in town making a movie. And so she served him at the restaurant she was working at. And I learned that he drank cappuccinos. And I think that made me maybe think on some level that if I drank cappuccinos, it would make me a better actor or singer, because I just think he's so good. So I started drinking cappuccinos for the dumbest reason ever and just haven't stopped. I drink cappuccinos and I drink black coffee, Americano or what have you. But I stopped doing sugar in my coffee like a few years ago, which has been really awesome.
That's good. Yeah. I mean, Sam Rockwell is a great actor.
I don't know if it's the cappuccinos that makes it good.
The correlation, you're like, you know what? We'll make that a hypothesis.
It's really similar to like me starting to smoke cigarettes, like, so I could be as good as the actors who smoke cigarettes and the musicians who smoke cigarettes. It's so stupid in retrospect.
I think we've all done it in some ways. But I mean, you know what? Sometimes you discover a love for something. You're like, hey.
For sure.
I like cappuccinos. I've definitely done that where I'm like, oh, they were pink? Okay, yeah, I'm going to do this.
Yeah. That's interesting you bring it up, because like, yeah, sometimes I definitely do like a kind of deep dive into some hero worship to kind of to try on different, you know, kind of things for the music and even for like style and stuff. Just kind of, you know, you see somebody wear you know, a series of cool outfits, and all of a sudden you're dressing just like them or what have you, you know.
Yeah. Oh no, you find your style. I always tell people like, yeah, when I started, I thought I was Missy Elliott. I had the energy and the mimicking exactly Missy Elliott. And then over time I was like, I'm a little more shy. I'm a bit more mellow.
Yeah.
My music is a bit more emotional than feel good that way. But maybe there's moments where it intersects, I want to say. And that's okay. And I'm happy about that. I'll proudly say it.
I think on some level, I think, I can't remember who was telling me this, but like with that in mind, like you want to be able to, if you ever meet, you know, Missy Elliott in your case, or, you know, like, I don't know, I can't meet most of the people that I look up to because they're all dead. But but like you want to be able to like hand them your album and and be proud and not just be like, this is me trying to be you, you know?
Yeah, that's true. But you know, music is timeless, and like you can, you probably are gonna be leaving your mark with, you know, the great ones, as they say. Be like, hey, I was part of that group, and I'm like, that's what I wish for people. It's like, yeah, I'm
the lineage of what's come before us in music and art and what have you to be in any way involved is such a pleasure and an honor, because yeah, this is, you know, I just, it's such a rich, incredible history. Like there's so many incredible, you know, movies and records you can listen to when anybody young ever asked me kind of what my advice would be if they want to do anything similar to what I've gotten up to. It's just like, dive in with both feet, like read every play, you know, watch every movie, listen to every record, just be a student of the game, because it's just so much fun.
That's so true. I think I couldn't agree more, and you heard it at first. If that's you out there, I hope that resonates with you. My other one thing that I'm going to ask you for tonight is, mm-hmm. what's one thing your friends always tell you?
Oh God. What do they tell me? different friends, different things. I definitely have my friends who will, you know, make fun of me for like having crushes. That's pretty popular. Just making fun of me for falling in love is popular.
I love that.
My bullshit. The ones who are always there for me in really, really supportive ways would probably tell me to believe in myself more, which I'm so, again, just stoked that, you know, I've met people who want to, who just have no interest in dimming my light, and we can all kind of appreciate each other and cheer each other on. There's been many times in my life where my artistic community did the opposite.
Yeah, that's important to have those types of friends, and I'm glad you have that community around you, that, you know, sometimes you want to be teased a little bit about your crushes, and sometimes you want to be like uplifted about it all too.
Totally.
I'm gonna switch it up to round five for you. This round is called If You Don't Know Now You Know. Behind the scenes, you perform a lot, and I did this round because I was like, I want people to know also the behind the scenes of everything, the things that we love, the things that we hate. So my question for you before I ask you that is, how did you get into your craft? Like, what's the behind the story of Charlie Kerr? And your craft, you have many crafts, so you can choose.
Yeah. I was always like the little performer. I was always like singing and pretending to be Luke Skywalker and what have you, around the house. And when I was, but at the same time, I was like painfully shy and uninterested in pretty much everything that, you know, my brothers were up to, and that, you know, it's like I had no interest in sports or what have you. And I think just one day I went up to my dad and asked for a guitar, and I think he was just so excited that I might have a hobby that he got me a guitar and lessons on the spot. And I was just so passionate about it immediately. I was so I was frightfully bad and untalented, but I just had lots and lots of passion. So I just spent hours and hours and hours in the basement or the garage or whatever, just making, trying to, you know, be better at guitar and singing. And I'm sure that it was very, very annoying for my family and friends. So, you know, yeah, that's pretty much it. And then for acting, when I was going to high school, it was the only thing that I succeeded in. I was a terrible student, and my school had a drama program, and I just kind of milked it for all it's worth. I wrote plays, and I was lucky to star in some of the plays, and it's the only subject where I got good grades. So when it came to what I was going to do with my life post-secondary, I knew I wanted to make music. I knew I wanted to be an actor. So I studied acting and I made music. And that was kind of the beginning of those journeys. But honestly, it's just very similar to what I like to do with my free time. You know, I like to be writing and making music, or if my friends come over who are creative, we're probably cracking jokes or doing things that could become a sketch or what have you. So
that's amazing. I always love hearing the behind the scenes and the stories of, like, yeah, you hear of the shy kid who, like, yeah, was playing in their basement on the guitar, and like, yeah, you might have been not as great as you are right now, but then eventually you're like, when I think of, yeah, are you shy on stage? I'm like, it doesn't look like it, like these days. But I think there's evolution. And sometimes, yeah, sometimes you find that thing that, like, ignites a bit more passion than the other things at school that you might be learning. So,
yeah, I had an incredible mentor who was really, really patient as well. My guitar teacher, Al, he could tell I wasn't coordinated enough to, like, learn scales. And I just wasn't that good a guitar player, but I showed him early on that I was trying to write songs, and I wasn't a very good singer either. But he would just, one day he kind of made the executive decision to turn our guitar lessons into songwriting lessons when I was like a kid. Nice. And that made so much more sense and was so valuable. And I want to kind of tell every educator to, build off a kid's strengths, because if somebody had not noticed that and just, you know, forced me to play scales and tried to do solos like Slash or whatever, it just would have been a disaster.
Yeah. Yeah. It's so important.
I had a great mentor.
Oh, shout out to them. Shout out to your mentor. And, like, yeah, a strength-based approach of, like, these are the strengths of the person I have in front of me, and how can I, like, leverage them and build it up? And then, yeah, eventually you might challenge yourself later on and try that scale and try those other things. But
yeah,
focus on the thing that's also in front of you at the time. That's I feel like that's what everybody needs sometimes.
Yeah, I feel like we'll work on our weaknesses naturally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and we need other people to point out our strengths.
Yeah, it's true. Well, some wisdom, who knew? I was like, a little pep talk for me this evening from you. In round five, I have another question. Yeah, I'd love to know.
I was listening to Yes Mama before this interview. I don't think you know.
I'm glad you were doing that. That's what a mood. You're like, okay, I'm gonna go talk to Missy. Might as well.
Hell yeah.
That's sweet. Thank you for doing that. Ralph, I was still behind the scenes. Since you've done a lot of shows, I'm curious, what's the thing you love the most about, you know, the show? And I mean, like, from sound check, from loading to sound check to the post show. What's the thing you love the most about those moments? And what's the thing you hate the most about or dislike about those
moments? I'd say what I love most is seeing the passion and happiness or sadness or whatever it is in the audience's eyes and connecting over this thing that I, you know, made I didn't think would work for anybody. And now there's, you know, plenty of people who connect to it, you know? Yeah, especially like songs like Speaking Off the Record and This Could Be It For Me. Like I wrote them because that was what was in my heart. I didn't think people would like find it to be that universal. Playing shows, especially these days, seeing that exchange of energy that's going on between the crowd and the band, there's nothing like it. It's really, really special. And then my least favorite thing is how nervous I get to be to perform every time I perform, either as an actor or as a musician. My stomach does just completely betrays me. My body can betray me in all sorts of ways. You know, you can get a sore throat out of nowhere that's, you know, psychosomatic or what have you. or you know, you're just like stiff when you try to do like a cool body roll or something, you know.
Yeah,
you're crazy.
At what point of the show, or is it when you get on stage that kind of decreases? Like what do you think happens physically in that moment?
A bit of that for sure. A bit of just getting on stage and hearing that, you know, I'm kind of in the right place via the audience is really special. A certain amount of it dissipates, but a certain amount of it maybe is healthy. Just it's good to know that whoever you're watching perform cares.
Yeah.
That they're giving a show, or that, you know, they're doing what they can to connect. So maybe the anxiousness or what have you is something, you know, perceived as a positive by the audience. I'll never know. You know, how things come off, and, you know, what I think is cool could be completely the most contrived part of the show for somebody, and vice versa. And it's, you know, I think I gravitate to the fact that, you know, we're drawn to vulnerability and flaws and stuff. So, you know, I try to remember that it's not meant to be the most polished thing in the universe when you see someone get up and try to you know, put themselves out there.
I truly believe that. In performing, singing, whenever I'm singing, I'm like, this is very vulnerable. Like, I feel like, because I've practiced rapping so long that I'm like, this is comfortable. Singing, I'm like, this is still very new to me. What is this? And I resonate with what you're saying. At the same time, I'm listening as like as someone that I've seen you perform, and I'm like, you're such a badass when you're on stage. Like, that's the best way I could describe it. It's like hearing you, and that's why I love these conversations. I'm like, yeah, I know I say that also to my friends, but I'm like, I'm nervous every show. And I'm like, you're nervous? I was like, you're like on stage, you're like gliding, rolling on the floor, the audience is singing along. I'm just like, I know I've been in the crowd being like, I want to be like him when I grow up, and growing up I'm grown, yeah. But you know,
and vice versa, like I would never, it would never cross my mind that it was something that you had nerves or reservations about. And yeah, it's shocking to learn that like singing is a thing for you that is kind of qualified as new ground, whereas rapping isn't, because to my ears it both sounded so natural and comfortable.
Thanks for that. I'm gonna switch it up. You're so nice. I'm like, okay, I gotta switch up the round. This is about you. Missy D interviews Charlie Kerr. So I'm gonna go back to you. Okay. With round six, it's called complete the sentence. So you just gotta complete the sentence. My go-to TV show is blank. Or movie, show, YouTube video. What do you watch these days?
Well, my favorite movies are Boogie Nights, The Birdcage, and Do the Right Thing. But my favorite show, I think, especially when I was like really deep in like PTSD kind of recovery and therapy, I needed things that brought me back to neutral or just to chill out. So I rewatched the same kind of comedies over and over again to kind of calm down. So I would watch a lot of The Office for that, and like Arrested Development and Insecure, Atlanta. Schitt's Creek is excellent. I watch a lot of TV.
You named quite a few shows, and I'm like,
yeah,
there's, and there are movies.
Yeah, my go-to show is unfortunately like a pretty like broad question. I apologize.
Oh no, this is good. By the way, I tell people I am usually taking notes, because I'm gonna watch this again and probably like be like, let me go watch this movie, let me go watch this show.
Oh sweet.
I love the recommendations, and for people watching, and I think like you mentioned, it might have come in moments that you needed, which I think is also a powerful message to send out.
You find
those outlets that can give you a little bit of laughter when things are still healing.
Yeah.
You're, to me, a great dancer. So my next question, or my next complete the sentence is, you know, if we're out and about and you're not performing and we're by the bar having a conversation, what's the song that comes on and you're like, Missy, you're great, but like, I gotta go show my dance moves.
Shit. That's such a good question. like Janelle Monáe comes to mind. The whole like Dirty Computer record. I was kind of obsessed with moving to that. There's a Redbone song called Come and Get Your Love that I can't resist. Come and get your love.
Oh, I think I've heard this.
Oh, it's so good. And then like anything Motown pretty much. What else? There's some really awesome like Fleetwood Mac and Blondie songs that come to mind as well. Yeah, I don't know. I'm so into all music and anything you can dance to at the end of the day.
I mean, you know, that sounds like a great playlist. If I'm ever catch you out and about, I'll be like,
hell yeah.
I know my DJ friends hate it when we go request songs, but these are the moments where I'll be like, come on, help my friend out. Let him groove a little bit. My next complete the sentence for you. Missy D should interview blank next. Who should I interview next?
Oh God. Okay. The OBGMs, Dens from the OBGMs, Cola, Joe, the OBGMs, I think would be a great interview. I think Crown Lands would be another great interview. I think Sky Wallace would be a good interview. Biawana would be sick. It'd be really cool to have you interview maybe one of the land defenders up at Ferry Creek. It's a cause that's very close to my heart. Yeah,
I'd love that. Yeah, I think I always tell people, like, my scope, what happened at the beginning, I was like, oh, I just want to check in with my friends and my community. It happened that a lot of people I had on Instagram were my music friends or like creative friends. So it started by that. And then eventually I was like, hey, y'all, I know some educators. I know some scientists. I know some people that are teachers. And I'm trying to get those folks as well heard on this platform. And then hopefully I can also interview people that I don't know. I love the names that you mentioned because there's a few of them that I'm like, I don't know who they are. So it's not just about my friends anymore. It's also about just meeting new people, meeting new community builders, land defenders. So I'm definitely going to keep this list building. I have a lot of names that I'm like, when will I interview them? I'll find time. And then people will get to see them. My last complete the sentence, there's two rounds left. You can complete the sentence. You can support me by blank.
Following us on all social media and telling your friends about us. More than anything, this band has succeeded via word of mouth, just people who were passionate about us telling their friends, and that's gotten us thus far. We'd be nothing without the fans, so it's kind of just about listening to the music, and if you dig it, telling more people. And then the TV show that I'm on, the finale airs next Monday, CTV at 7 p.m. So if you tuned into that, that'd be awesome.
I love that. That's actually going to be what I do this weekend, because I didn't have time to watch it yet. I'm gonna be streaming Jan, is that the name, right?
Yep.
So I'm gonna be checking it out. I was like, oh, I wanted to watch it before the interview and I didn't have a chance to, and I'm like,
all good,
it's gonna happen, which I love new shows. So I'm like, oh, I get to watch a new show and it happens that I happen to know one of the characters in it. It's like extremely exciting.
Oh, it's a really, it's a beautiful show too. It's got a great heart.
I'm gonna check it out. Okay, two more rounds, they're almost done. Hopefully you're enjoying this.
I'm having a great time.
Thanks. Round seven is called Flip It and Reverse It. It's your So of course I named a round after Missy Elliott. But I named it Flip It and Reverse It because I ask a lot of questions, and one of my friends was like, Missy, I came with a question, or I want to ask you a question, or do we get to ask you questions? Can it be back to back and like conversation? I was like, it's Missy D interviews Charlie Kerr, not the other way around. But for this round, it's Flip It and Reverse It. So you get to ask me a question with the Flip It, Reverse It. that question comes back to you. So, Charlie Kerr, what is your question for Missy D?
Okay. Like on the song, Yes Mama, you sing really beautifully about, from what I can tell, this person who supported you and you check in with, and I just want to know kind of from your perspective, kind of what it's been like to have somebody in your corner, kind of like that's so close to you.
So interesting. Thank you for that question. I've not been asked that question before. I think Yes Mama, it's interesting because I think it's evolved into different versions. I always tell people when I first wrote it, it was also like, if you ever talk to like someone in your life and like they're giving you advice and you're like, yes, I get it. It was that kind of Yes Mama. At the beginning, I was like, yes, Ma, like I get it. You're giving me all this advice. I don't get it why, but I'm listening. So it stemmed from that, where I wasn't in agreement with my mom. I was more,
oh, word.
I was more like, you're preaching to me and I don't want to hear this right now. I'm tired of all the drama that's happening and all these different stories. And it was at the end of my dad passing away that it hit me like an epiphany. I was like, oh shoot, what she was saying was so true, like so real and so honest. And it's like it changed into like a happier Yes Mama, even though in reality there's a lot of sadness behind it. There's like this happiness. Sorry, I'm making
I
cry.
I didn't think that was gonna make me cry.
I'm so sorry.
No, it's cool. I'm happy that I don't know, that I'm not a robot or whatever, because it's pretty beautiful.
Thank you. Thanks for that's why I was surprised. Like not a lot of people know that side of the story. That's a little bit sad. If you watch the video, maybe there's a couple of friends of mine know that like the video ends with a picture of my dad. So if you know that this song is about a mom and like it ends with a picture of my dad, you might be like, hey, wonder what the story is about.
Right.
It's as much as a song about my dad, who have a very complicated, I had a complicated relationship with, but being also like, man, I want to celebrate this. I was, you know, I don't know, you start understanding your like parents as you get older and like being like, oh man, they're human. So that song is a bit of that. Like I'm celebrating her because I'm like, she's such a human and she is that person that maybe I call up and sometimes she has the answer, sometimes she doesn't know the answer, because like she's also living through it all. And then a part of me is like, sometimes I'm people's like go-to person and I'm also like,
yes,
I don't know it all, but I think I want to celebrate those people. I want to honor those people. And then hopefully people find a bit of joy in it, which I was also happy about singing some joy, because usually I sing a more, it might be an upbeat beat, but it's also about like my pain and da da da. And I'm like,
yeah, like a song like Paint, right? Like,
yeah.
It really is. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. So that's the story behind it. I was like, no, you're crying. But also I'm happy you're crying, like in terms of, yeah, you're not a robot. This is real talk, real conversations type of.
No, it's, I mean, yeah, I, my dad, had a health scare, last, year, I guess. Mm. And, yeah, I mean, we've had a complicated, relationship at times, but, man, when his mortality became evident, I just realized how much I love him and will always love him, and just how flawed he is, but he's trying. And I think that's all we can really ask of anyone, is to be flawed and trying.
That's so true.
Yeah, no. Family's a whole thing.
Yeah,
it's a whole different podcast. But
I mean, we can make it happen. We can always make it happen.
Totally. Interesting. Yeah, because okay, then it's more similar to like to how things have been with my dad, where it's kind of it can be touch and go in terms of sometimes it's pearls of wisdom that I figure out later, and sometimes it's not stuff that I should you know, take personally or whatever, you know. It's can be generational and kind of you know, we put our folks on pedestals and stuff, but you know, they're just people, and it's so much more comforting and livable when they are just people, and they don't have to be everything.
Yeah, I feel that. I think this is Missy D interviews Charlie Kerr. I'm like, I'm working on this project. Well, it connects to what you're saying in terms of like, I'm not in this stage. I don't know if it's a stage of grief where I'm trying to, to unpack a bit of that, of like the person, the human. Because there was like the denial, the shock, and all these different feelings. And then now I'm like more like, okay, this person was the person I called dad, but also there's other parts to him and other components to him that I don't know. There's good, bad, ugly, beautiful moments that I'm trying to hold on to, and the memories that I'm trying to not forget. Which is very powerful. But I think, like when people ask me that question about Yes Mom, I'm always like, it's a happy song, but there's also like, for me, there's also, and I love performing. It's one of my favorite songs to perform. And I remember the joy out of it, but when I look back into when I started writing it, I was like, oh yeah, I was probably more sad than anything, or more caught up in pain. So I was definitely caught up in more in like, ooh, intergenerational pain. My pain is your pain. And what is all this? So it's interesting you're asking that. This was flip it and reverse it. So I feel like it's a lot of Missy D talking right now, so I'm gonna flip it back to you, reverse it back to you. The song that I'm curious to know, there's a couple of songs that I had in mind. Yeah. I mean, we listened to The Eyes on You.
Yeah.
What inspired you to write that song? Or if you don't want to talk about that song, like, what would you say? What song was the most exciting to write from this project that you had?
I mean, I can talk about The Eyes on You. I think it's kind of an interesting song because it's about it might sound like a love song, but it's about a really codependent romantic relationship where the narrator was trying so desperately to make somebody see that they were lovable and all their potential. And if only you saw you the way I saw you, like, oh my God, we'd just be off to the races. But it's that's a really, really unfair and exhausting process. As good-hearted as it may seem. So the first verse kind of goes into you know, just being in love with this person and thinking they're the bee's knees, and then you go into the chorus where it kind of explains you've got nothing to be insecure about. When we go out, everybody's looking at you. But then also the world, I explicitly say that the world is cruel, and maybe things have gone on in your life that is, you know, made you feel unlovable or unworthy, and you know, we can address that too. And and then the second verse is kind of about when things have gotten so exhausting with you kind of supporting this person through their things, that now you need all this support. And you know, it's kind of the tent poles of codependence. So now your role was caretaker, and now you're being caretaken by this person who's, you know, just doing their best. And it's just like, yeah, it's a really unhealthy dynamic. And then the bridge is kind of, it's related but it's unrelated. It's like it's kind of like a quick statement on the awful systems in the world that make us feel that we're unlovable or unworthy for arbitrary reasons. And it's, you know, the line is, nobody told us that, nobody told me that crows could be lovebirds too, you know? So it's me kind of asking, you know, who decides what's a flower and what's a weed? And I think a lot of it is steeped in white supremacy and patriarchy. And I just wanted there to be some sort of line in the song about, you know, the nature versus nurture of it, where society for the most part has made this person hate themselves and or not think that they're worthy of things. So yeah, I mean, crows are beautiful animals that, you know, take care of each other and have incredible qualities. And yeah, and specifically, the crow is a sacred animal to indigenous people. And yeah, so it's kind of, that's what The Eyes on You is about, even though it just kind of sounds like a love song.
You like me, yeah? I think you created a new round for this Missy D interviews, because I'm like so intrigued to like unpack a lot of the songs I heard. Like you mentioned speaking of the record, like there's so many songs that I was listening to, and I was actually watching it with I was watching the videos with subtitles just to like listen to the lyrics. So I have a feeling that in the future, because I'm probably going to interview you again and do this.
I would love
again.
That
I'd love to unpack and like maybe create a new round where I kind of unpack the words and like see the structure of a song and how it, because it's storytelling at the end of the day. So you're beautifully storytelling this, like, the dynamics that go in a codependent relationships, but also society within that circle of things. And then how those different moments are in different sections of the songs. It's like a songwriting 101 for some people, maybe. But it's, I think it's fascinating to know that, when I first heard it, for sure, to the untrained or just the pleasant ear, I was like, oh, it sounds like a love song. And then I was like, oh, you have crushes on people apparently. So maybe, and then someone's created this song out of it. But I'm also like happy to hear the different facets of it.
I think if I'm being honest with myself, like I was as kind of fooled by it as well, you know, like, I think at the time of writing it, I thought maybe there was things that were like romantic or poetic about what was going on. and needing to like take those steps back to understand that things were unhealthy.
Well, thank you for creating that round that I still have to find a name. I don't know, but behind the song, behind the lyrics, type of conversation. So that was a great question from you to me. Flip it, reverse it back to you. I know I'm over time and I apologize. I'm sure you got things to do. I got one last question for you. This is my last round. Round nine is called Last Words, I think.
Yeah.
It's probably round eight. I messed up. But hey, last words. What would you tell your younger self? And that could be last week, because you know you were younger last week.
It's true.
Or you could tell, you know, younger you listening to the tunes back in 2005. Or if not, what would you tell yourself right now? Or what would you tell the people watching, listening to this at one point?
I think if I could tell my younger self anything, it would be, you know, keep going. Everyone's calling you a weirdo. Everyone's, you know, calling you a freak. You're getting ridiculed a lot. But one day you'll be professionally weird. You'll be, you know, you'll be weird today, and things will flip and people will be into it all of a sudden. I'd probably get to say that, you know, you're on TV as an actor and people care about your music. If you know, if you decide to keep going, if you decide to keep living, that was a very disturbed and confused and kind of curious, naive kid. So I'd probably also tell him the lesson. With some people, mean to do you harm. Some people mean to hurt you, to hit you right where it hurts. Like, that is some people's goal, even though my personal experience of doing harm is it's always accidental. So I didn't really understand the concept of somebody being shitty or trying to destroy you. It just made no sense to me, and that made my whole life really confusing. So probably give him that advice and then say, you know, a lot of the things that, you know, I set out to do, I got to do, you know, just by staying alive and working at it and being really, really lucky and privileged. And now hopefully I'm doing what I can to give back to kids that are in a similar place.
Thank you for sharing, and thank you for being vulnerable and in front of us all. I think, like, a lot of things, when I ask this question, I always say, like, I hope it echoes back to you today. And like, that you're able to hear out of it, like, reflection of, like, who you were once, where you've been, and knowing that, like, today, like, yeah, like, you are here. I'm happy you're here. I'm happy that people are caring about your music, caring about you. And then, like, you know, one of my friends said, oh, can I talk to my future self? And I'm like, I wish you the same for the future. where, you know, you get more of that, you know, the professional weirdo is great. It's the new thing. And like you said, like crows are lovebirds too. I love the metaphor and the poetic aspects of even that line. I'm like, yeah, that's true. Why does it have to be always doves and, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. As, yeah, you Google beautiful woman and there's a pretty consistent image.
It's a pretty weird Google to do. I've definitely done that one. Like, so that's it.
All right. Okay. All right. That's one kind of beautiful woman, I guess.
Yeah. There's 7 billion people, right? I don't know. Like, I think we can do better on this app. I'm really grateful that, yeah, I was able to share and hold space with you and get to know you more. I feel like I'm excited to see you at another show and be like, hey, want to do this in person with no people recording catching up.
I vote for the next time we get to do this, we do it safely in person, because, yeah, it was a gigantic pleasure, but I think it would be even better without the gods of technology.
Oh yeah. I'm gonna close it. Yeah. I agree. Well, this was Missy D Interviews, Charlie Kerr. Thank you, Charlie, for being here. I'm gonna stop recording. People, go check out Hotel Mira. Go check out Jan. And hopefully you felt something, you heard something, and take good care of each other. Peace.
My pleasure. Love you lots. Peace.